Prince Caitlin are nurtured with whom we at Leeds Minster have a particularly fruitful working relationship. We do know with a fair degree of confidence that St George was a soldier of the Roman army, that he was and is one of the most famous of the early Christian martyrs, having lost his life in the persecution of Christians under the Emperor Diocletian. And there is very good evidence that St George was known in Britain long, long before the Norman conquest. And of course, as you do well know, the best known story of St George comes from the late Middle Ages in a book called The Golden Legend, in which St George is depicted as an exemplar, an example of chivalrous knighthood, who rescued a princess from a fearsome dragon. And that is said to have led to thousands of people being baptised as Christians. According to the legends, the brave knight of St George then vanished, but certainly not forever, it would seem, because other stories also appeared in various parts of the world, of St George rescuing maidens, defeating dragons, turning the tide of battles in favour of those on the side of peace and justice. So I think it's all the more intriguing that St George, as well as a great Christian martyr, is also venerated as a holy man by Muslims, identified as a dragon slayer by Islamic sources, and associated with the Islamic spiritual tradition of Al-Qaeda, and indeed the cult of the Green Man. And the Green Man is not just a pub name in this country, but a figure from Celtic folkloric spiritual sources, which are akin to those which claim that Joseph of Arimathea brought the young Jesus Christ to this country, and then later on the Holy Grail, here to England's green and pleasant land. These, of course, are the stories and sources which undergird William Blake's eloquent and celebrated rhetorical question: and did those seas in ancient time walk upon England's mountains green? Well, as you will no doubt know, recent comments of the Prime Minister, notably in an article in the Church Times a fortnight ago, have provoked a national debate concerning whether or not England is still a Christian country, and if so, what that means for us. So I do think it's very well aware that those who have entered the debate do recognise that a whole succession of prime ministers across the political spectrum and into modern times have been practising Christians, whether as members of the Church of England, the Roman Catholic Church, the Church of Scotland,